This week on Jerusalem Dateline, Russia's airstrikes are tipping the balance in Syria, how Putin and Assad are growing stronger while the U.S. is seen as weak. Plus, Iran's missile program, how the Islamic Republic is working to become a regional superpower. And this pastor refuses to flee the danger and despair in Syria because people desperately need his church. Hello and welcome to this edition of Jerusalem Dateline. I'm Chris Mitchell, coming to you from just outside the walls of the Old City. Despite a ceasefire agreement in Syria, many analysts say that the situation on the ground remains the same. In fact, they say it could even get even worse. Russia stands to gain more power as critics blast President Obama for showing weakness in the conflict. In Munich, the U.S., Russia, and European powers agreed to allow humanitarian relief into Syria and a cessation of hostilities throughout the country. Still, the Russians continue to bomb rebel forces supported by the U.S. and Saudi Arabia.
The Russians will not stop their air raids, and with the ground support of Hezbollah, Iranian, and other Shiite militias worldwide coming from Afghanistan, from Tajikistan, from other places, I think the Russians and the Iranians want to make Assad regime survive, and they will do everything. Now they are on the offense. I think they will not stop at nothing.
Syrian and Iranian forces, backed by Russian airstrikes, are closing in on Aleppo, Syria's largest city. If they take the city, it could change the course of the war and strike a major blow to President Obama's Middle East policy.
Located in northwest Syria, Aleppo is one of the rebels' last strongholds. There was a stalemate between the rebels and the Assad regime until Russia came in and tipped the scales.
Some months into the Russian intervention, the sense right now is it really is beginning to take hold and have a very powerful effect on the battlefield, to the detriment of the rebellion and to the advantage of the Assad regime.
While the fate of a faraway Syrian city might seem unimportant to Americans, it represents a major geopolitical shift in the region.
The substantial Russian military buildup in Syria and the Eastern Mediterranean is also shifting the strategic balance in this part of the Mediterranean. So I call on calm, de-escalation, and a political solution to the conflict in Syria.
Yet Middle East expert Jonathan Speier believes Russia wants a battlefield solution.
If they succeed in that, it means that the Syrian map of protagonists, so to speak, will leave only the regime itself with its Russian, Iranian, and Iranian backers, the Kurds, and Islamic State. It'll be a very major change. That, I think, is what Putin and his allies are going for.
If Putin, Assad, and Iran succeed, it means a setback for the U.S. and the West.
If they achieve this goal, would have achieved strategic victory in a vital conflict zone in the Middle East. There's no such thing as a vacuum. This is a zero-sum game. So growing strength for the Russians and the Iranians means growing perceived weakness for the West.
We are now in the midst of meta historic change in the Middle East, and the United States is not there.
Many people believe it really is a historic change in the region. Well, one thing that hasn't changed is the violence and bloodshed. A Russian airstrike destroyed a hospital run by the international aid group Doctors Without Borders in northern Syria. At least 9 people are dead and several others wounded or missing. The group says the hospital was deliberately targeted. All members of the medical team inside the structure are believed to be dead. The hospital provided medical care to an area of more than 40,000 people. The Islamic Republic of Iran says it will continue to pursue its ballistic missile program in order to defend itself. Other countries contend the missiles are part of Iran's goal to become a Middle East superpower that would threaten Israel, the United States, and other enemies.
Iran's missile program is one of the most ambitious in the world. Its arsenal ranges from long-range ballistic missiles that could reach Europe to shorter-range missiles already used by regional terror groups against Israel and Saudi Arabia.
Officially, the claim is that the missile industry is for defense purpose only. As for the long-range missiles, it's obviously not a defensive tool.
The U.S. and 5 world powers lifted most of the international sanctions as part of their nuclear deal with Iran. The UN Security Council still called for work to stop on ballistic missiles that can carry nuclear weapons. Iran never complied and now argues its missile program has nothing to do with the deal.
In addition, Iranian President Hassan Rouhani ordered an expansion of the missile program. Commander Ali Hajizadeh says Iran's Revolutionary Guard Corps will get two new advanced missiles when the Persian New Year begins in March. Both will have a range of more than 1,000 miles. Ayelet Savion is the Iranian expert with the Middle East Media Research Institute here in Jerusalem. She says from time to time, Iranian officials speak openly about the missile program.
They kept saying that the main purpose of their long-range missile was hitting, targeting Israel.
Even with the nuclear deal in place, Iranian commanders taught the U.S. about their missiles and military capability.
We have land-to-sea missiles with very heavy warheads located in tunnels along the Persian Gulf coastline. The Americans themselves once said that the IRGC Navy forces had dug over 1,000 tunnels along the coast of the Persian Gulf.
Ali Fadavi is the Iranian Revolutionary Guard Corps Navy commander.
When will the Americans learn about the things we haven't shown them? We will demonstrate this at a certain point in accordance with our interests or when the time is right. At that point, the Americans will know our abilities and it will be too late for them.
Earlier, Iranian television revealed the missile tunnels, saying they had around 500 of them.
Almost all Iranian cities have at least one missile base. What you see is like an iceberg floating on the water, some part of which is only visible. We have so many such bases that even if they manage to identify some of them, it still will be to no avail.
Savion says the admission of the tunnels has to do with regional tensions.
I think they said it because of the tension being so escalating between Iran and Saudi Arabia. They said we have hidden cities of missiles.
And it's not an idle threat.
They also said that they equipped Israel's neighboring Islamic movements such as Hezbollah and Hamas and other Palestinian groups such as Islamic Jihad with Iranian technology and missiles.
Retired IDF officer Michael Segal says Iran is setting its sights high.
They want to create some kind of a balance of power with the United States, with other European players. And if Iran is on its way to become a superpower, and the missile program is indeed a pillar in the Iranian national security doctrine.
Up next, ministry in a war zone. This pastor refuses to abandon his flock or his community for safety in America. Welcome back to Jerusalem Dateline. More than 5 million have fled the fighting in Syria, most of them from the city of Aleppo. We talked to a pastor from that city in Washington, D.C. Reverend Harut is an Armenian evangelical pastor who insists on returning to his city of Aleppo. As he told CBN's Abigail Robertson, now more than ever, Christians need to be in the country ministering to Syria's citizens.
We hear a lot about the refugees who are fleeing Syria, but what's going on with those who've decided to remain in the country? I want to share with you all an interview I did with Reverend Harut, an Armenian evangelical pastor who's decided to stay in Syria, protect his church, and be there for the people who are struggling with the ongoing civil war. Take a look at what he says.
Our life became so dangerous and we are feeling more responsible towards the people that we are serving. This torn apart nation needs people that they are filled with the spirit and with love, with passion. And we are trying to be there as long as the war is there. Then when I come back to my office, I start writing as if I'm writing the history of Syria during the war.
In Aleppo, do you feel like the community is empty, or do you still feel like there's a strong sense of community there?
The community is still there, though many left, and half of Syrian population nowadays, they are scattered all over the world, and they are becoming now under the status of refugee. We have to be there, we have to be protective to our churches, our schools, and our social clubs. And, you know, still we are very much concerned about all those who went out, because we are hearing so many stories that they are not in good shape. Many still are living in social halls of the churches in Toronto, in Montreal, and in other places. And some families also, they are calling us in Aleppo, in Syria, and saying, Pastor, if you can manage something, we are planning to come back with a family, to come back home to Aleppo, because we don't want to stay like this all over years.
So have shops and schools been able to stay open?
We have shops and we have schools, especially under the government jurisdiction area. We are continuing our life semi-normal, but we are trying to make life get progress. For instance, the schooling system in Syria still is functioning as if nothing is going on in Syria.
Do you feel safe there?
My spirit is calm, and we are very much trusted to God, and every day we feel that God is protecting us and God is stretching his hand over Syria. So we are facing so many danger, we are facing so many problems and fear, but the spirit is giving us that calamity.
So you have no plans to leave?
No, I don't want to leave. I have to be with my people, with the community, as the head of the Armenian Protestant churches in Syria. God called me to be there, and being a pastor is not for good days only. Is for all the time, is for all days. Two weeks before, I preached on the subject when Jesus was tempted and tested in the desert. The point was that the faith should be tested. And the Satan is, if surrounding us, it's not that we should leave the desert and go and leave the place for Satan. Jesus stayed there. We are going to stay there, and we are going to say to the Satan, go back. If the Christian faith is not tested, you will not see how real it is and how powerful it is. So that the power of the Christian faith always comes during the test. And how we're going to be tested by fire. And the fire is all the time, all over the community. So we have many challenges, and today I believe that our Christian faith is challenged as well. So this is the time not to leave, this is the time to stay and to give testimony to the marvelous work that God is doing in our lives.
So do you feel like God is really in the country of Syria and moving in Syria right now?
I do believe so. I do believe that God is under control. I mean, everything is under control of God.
Have any Muslims reached out to you for help and comfort?
Our church and our church courtyard is located in a Muslim-dominated people, and everybody comes to our polyclinic, and they come to our social service action center, and we try to stretch hand and help, especially when the water cuts off from Aleppo. We feel so good that whatever we have from richness or from possibilities, accessibilities, we try to share it with the community without any discrimination. This is our teaching, this is our faith, and this is how to be a Syrian in Syria.
As Reverend Harut says, God is moving in the Middle East, and we must continue to lift up our brothers and sisters standing for their faith right now.
After hearing that interview, we'd like to encourage you to pray for the church in Syria. You can go to our Jerusalem Dateline Facebook and Twitter pages and leave your prayers and comments with the hashtag #PrayForSyria. Up next, the resurrection story through the eyes of an unbeliever. Actor Joseph Fiennes talks about his role in the new movie, Risen, after this. Welcome back to Jerusalem Dateline. Turkish archaeologists have uncovered a 5th century underground church with artwork showing scenes of Jesus rising into the sky. A Turkish news agency reports the church was discovered as archaeologists are excavating the world's largest known underground city. The 5,000-year-old city includes 3.5 miles of tunnels and escape galleries. It is believed that early Christians used the city to hide from persecution after the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. 5 other churches have previously been discovered in that city. Archaeologists say they hope to discover even more original paintings. Resurrection Sunday is just about a month away, and part of your celebration can include a film called Risen. It picks up where the Passion of the Christ left off. It tells the story of the resurrection and crucifixion of Jesus through the eyes of an unbelieving Roman military officer. Charlene Aaron talked to many of the people who made the film.
Risen is the resurrection story as seen through the eyes of an unbelieving Roman soldier. British actor Joseph Fiennes plays Clavius.
I thought that particular lens through the eyes of a Roman tribune who is there to quell these uprisings where messiahs pop up every week before the emperor of Rome arrives, that he has to bring order along with Pontius Pilate to Judea. And out of that, he falls into the greatest murder mystery of all time.
Clavius and his aide Lucius, played by English actor Tom Felton, are tasked by Pontius Pilate with ensuring that Jesus' followers don't steal his body and claim he's risen from the dead. Felton, known for his role as Draco Malfoy in the Harry Potter franchise, says he was drawn to the story's creative take on biblical events.
The biblical story, or the biblical side of the story, is something that I've grown up with, and I know a lot of my generation has it's kind of ingrained and instilled in us in a way. So to have the opportunity to tell those stories from a completely different perspective was really exciting. And sort of made it, put a different twist on probably the world's most famous story.
Rich Peluso of Sony's faith-based Affirm Films is one of the project's producers. He hopes Risen continues the box office success of faith-based films.
This is a real valid storytelling perspective. And I think with research, it shows, you know, 127 million Americans go to a Christian church every week. That shows that faith-based storytelling is not a niche. It is mainstream.
Some say Risen picks up where the 2004 blockbuster Passion of the Christ left off, something producer Mickey Lydell says is a tall order.
Obviously, that was done so well, so beautiful. You know, in every way, we wanted to try to repeat that high quality of a filmmaking.
Meanwhile, Peluso hopes audiences see Risen as more than just another story about the Bible.
I want believers to walk out of that film just energized and excited and just blown away from the other side of the story and really refreshed and going back to the scripture. For non-believers, I want them to really wonder, maybe Christ really rose, maybe he rose, and start to think about and dig into the evidence that they have right in front of them.
Risen opens in theaters February 19th. Charlene Aaron, CBN News.
Another part of your Resurrection Sunday celebration can include watching our broadcast of the sunrise service live from the Garden Tomb here in Jerusalem. When we return, the House of Life. How this ministry is helping single mothers in Israel. Welcome back to Jerusalem Dateline. Jewish people come from all over the world to begin new lives, but for some, it's harder to start over than it is for others. That's why CBN established the House of Hope.
Masha Poplovsky moved from Ukraine to Israel, hoping to make a better life for her son, Daniel.
It's very hard to raise a child in Ukraine. There aren't many jobs, and the war has made things difficult. Being a Jew, I had always heard about Israel, and it was my dream to come here.
Masha and her son stayed with Ukrainian friends when they first arrived. But the apartment was very small, and the friend soon asked her and Daniel to leave.
I was very depressed. I wanted to make it on my own, but I didn't know the language or how to find a job or an apartment yet. I was scared we would have to go back to Ukraine.
When CBN Israel learned about Masha, we invited her to come live in the House of Life, a place where single moms who need some extra help can stay free of charge.
I was very nervous at first, but the CBN people spoke Russian and made me feel very comfortable. I made friends with the other girls very quickly.
We taught Masha how to budget her finances and build a resume. She learned the basics of living in Israel and saved money while staying in the house. We also provided Masha and Daniel with good meals every day.
The people there really became my family, and I learned so much in the house. It was a great experience.
Masha and her son recently moved into their own apartment. Today, Masha supports Daniel on her own, but we still visit just to make sure they're okay.
There is no way we would have made it without your help. This situation in Ukraine is terrible for my baby, so going back would have been horrible. We were only able to stay in Israel because CBN helped us in every way possible. Thank you for that.
It's a blessing to be able to help people start new lives here in Israel. Well, that's it for this edition of Jerusalem Dateline. Remember, you can follow us throughout the week on Facebook and Twitter. I'm Chris Mitchell. We'll see you next time on Jerusalem Dateline.
Israel and the Middle East, center of the world for thousands of years, and still creating headlines that reach back to the Bible. CBN News makes that connection each week with the groundbreaking program, Jerusalem Dateline.
Hello and welcome to this edition of Jerusalem Dateline.
Hosted by award-winning correspondent Chris Mitchell, Jerusalem Dateline brings a Christian perspective to events that literally change history.
In fact, as many as a million people here in Tahrir Square. Right now, we're just running back into the bomb shelter. The siren just went off.
We take you to the action, whether it's the front lines or underground, digging into the past for discoveries.
Justin here, reaching out.
Or in the footsteps of Jesus. Jerusalem Dateline is your window to Israel, Jerusalem, and the Middle East.
We'll see you next time on Jerusalem Dateline.
If you would like to broadcast Jerusalem Dateline or want more information, contact us at the address on your screen.